Good morning. Welcome to all of those you who are here today. It's good to see you. Welcome to those joining us on the live stream. And it's Father's Day. And so today we're not only recognizing our earthly fathers, but we are going to sing praises to the perfect, the perfectly good and righteous Father that we have in God. So if you'll stand, we'll begin to sing songs about God and his graciousness towards us.
I was an orphan lost at the fall, running away when I hear your call. But Father, you worked your will. I had no righteousness of my own, I had no right to draw near your throne. But Father, you love me still. And in love before you laid the world's foundation, you predestined to adopt me as your own. You have raised me up so high above my station. I'm a child of God by grace and grace alone. Your home to seek out the lost. You knew the great and terrible cost. But Jesus, your face was set. I run my fingers down to the bone. Nothing I did could ever atone. But Jesus, you paid my debt. With your blood I have redemption and salvation. Lord, you died that I might reap what you have sown. And you rose that I might be a new creation. I am born again by grace and grace alone. In darkness all of my life, I never knew the day from the night. The Spirit you made me see. I swore I knew my way on my own. Head full of rocks, a heart made of stone. The Spirit you moved in me. At your touch my life was free. On my darkened heart, the light of Christ has shone. Called into a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Heaven sits and by grace and grace alone. So I'll stand and faith by grace and grace alone. Don't outrun the race by grace and grace alone. I will slay my sin by grace and grace alone. I will reach the end by grace and grace alone.
Amen.
Amen. What a truth we sing. The testimony of Scripture is that we are completely dependent on our God for salvation. That salvation is the work of God from beginning to end. And He alone gets the glory, and we get the favor. Completely undeserved, we get the benefit of Christ's sacrifice. Will you pray with me? Great God, thank you. Your word tells us that you are the author and the finisher of faith. that you grant faith as a gift, that you grant repentance unto salvation, that salvation is found in you and in you alone, and Jesus, yours is the only name under heaven whereby we can be saved, whereby we can be forgiven of sin, reconciled to the eternal God, and promised the hope of eternal life. Scripture is clear that it is by your grace that we're saved, that no one comes to the Father unless you, Jesus, draw that person. So yes, we confess, grace alone. You have awoken our spiritually dead and lifeless souls. You have breathed life into us by the regenerating power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you for your gift of love, for your gift of life. We glorify you as your children today. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, you may be seated. Well, good morning. Thank you for being here today and worshiping with us on this Father's Day Sunday here, June 19th. Just let me say a word to fathers in this room. Your role in the family, your role in the church, your role in society is so important. Thank you for the way that you love the Lord. Thank you for the way that you seek him. Thank you for the way that you are fearing the one true and living God. And thank you for the way that you are loving and leading your family, loving your spouse, your wife, and loving and discipling your children. Let us continue to be men who strive to seek the Lord, celebrating the grace that he's given, the Spirit who lives in us, enabling us to live for his glory and to love and to lead in the way that he has called us to do. Well, again, good morning. We're so glad that you're here. If you are visiting with us today for the first time or for the first time in a long time, or if you've never filled out one of those blue-topped visitor cards that's located in the pew rack right in front of you, if you do us a favor and take that visitor card and fill out the information that it asks, and then at the conclusion of the service, you can place it in one of the giving boxes or take it to our Welcome Center, just out those doors and then off to your left. We would love to connect with you. We'd love to know you're here. We'd love to get to know you a little bit better and then provide an avenue for you to get to know us a little bit better as well. And if you are watching on the live stream today, we're glad that you've kind of checked us out that way. Maybe you are a member of our church and you can't be here today, or maybe you live in Amarillo and you're just kind of looking for churches. We would encourage you to come visit with us in person. Or maybe you don't live in Amarillo, maybe you live somewhere else and you just happen to find your way. God has you here for a reason today, and we're glad that you're worshiping with us. Please feel free to click that connect card. You can fill out some information, let us know of any prayer requests or question you have. We would love to be able to connect with you and know that you are worshiping with us today. Well, at Trinity Baptist Church, we exist to proclaim Christ, to make disciples of those who claim Christ, all for the glory of Christ. And we do that as we gather to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. We do that through participation in local ministries and ministries to the ends of the earth. We do that through the way that we support missionaries. We do that through the teaching of the Word of God and the praise of the Son of God, the praise of our great God. And we do that through fellowship as well, as we as a church gather together to enjoy one another. And tonight we have that opportunity at Austin Park at 6 o'clock to gather together as a church. All ages, come. We're going to have a cookout. We want you to be there. Zach Scoggin will give us some more information about that at the end of the service, but right now, it's going to be a great evening to gather together with the church family and also to help welcome Hunter and Heather Wilkerson to our church and to our church staff. Well, as you know, church, I've been out of town all week leading up here to this Sunday at the Southern Baptist Convention annual meeting, which was held in Anaheim, California. We are a Southern Baptist church. We partner voluntarily with about 45,000 other Southern Baptist churches for the purpose of supporting missions, doing ministry, church planning, theological education, and other initiatives, ministry initiatives. And I want to just give you a brief update. There were a few tense moments at the convention, but at the end of the day, I believe we took the right steps as a convention to deal with some of the issues that have become front and center, especially over the course of the past few years. That would include with how we deal with and think through and combat any sort of sexual abuse that could be taking place in churches and amongst leaders, how we're able to care for people who have been victims of sexual abuse. So I think we've made some right decisions, and I think that we can say today that we are a convention that still believes in the truth of God's word, the inerrancy of God's word, the sufficiency of Scripture, has a passion for missions, and wants to see the gospel go to the ends of the earth. So my commitment to you is to continue to be a voice for theological accuracy and commitment to the sufficiency and inerrancy of Scripture in the local church, but also even at a convention level. So one other thing, this morning, Daniel Coward is going to be preaching God's word. I'm grateful for Daniel. He's one of my closest friends. So grateful for their family. And we are grateful as a church, we are blessed as a church to have the Cowards as part of our church family. Today he's teaching in Acts chapter 15, which is such a significant text in the New Testament. And I've heard him preach it already. I'm excited to sit through it again and to hear him preach it again. And I know you will be encouraged as well. So we're going to pray that God's word would powerfully work in us today as we humble ourselves before him, seek to listen to what his spirit will be teaching us today. Amen? All right, let's stand and continue with our worship service.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Find me, all my fears and failures, fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I
Savior, he can move the mountains.
mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene.
Chapter 7, verses 18 through 20. It says, who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity and passing over transgression for the remnant of his inheritance? He does not retain his anger forever because he delights in the steadfast love.
He will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. You will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea.
You will show faithfulness to Jacob and steadfast love to Abraham, as you have sworn to our fathers from the days of old.
Praise the Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Remember no wrongs we had done. Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Patience would wait as we constantly roam. What Father so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What riches of kindness He lavished on us. His blood was the payment, His life was the cost. We stood near the dead we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Amen. That is our proclamation this morning. That is our cry and our recognition, Lord, that You, apart from You moving in us, we are hopeless and helpless. So God, we just, as we transition now into the time of preaching, show us in Your word that You are good in Your grace and that You are the one who moves first. By grace alone, we are saved. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, praise team, for leading us this morning in our worship. It's always a blessing to see how God is using the gifts that He has granted all of you and so wonderfully leading us each week. Always a blessing. Thank you. Well, happy morning, happy Father's Day. It's a great day. It's a great day at the Coward House. Now, Bama is in Korea today. She left yesterday, and I've already got video of a laughing baby in Nana's arms. We're blessed that she's able to be with David on his first Father's Day. And we're also blessed to have our kids, our oldest, Jonna, and her husband, Stacy, and kids, John, Casey, and Mamie, are in Amarillo now, living in Amarillo. He'll be working at Amarillo High, and she at Paladura. We're blessed now to have grandkids in our midst. So we're very, very thankful on this Father's Day in particular. Well, it's a pleasure for me and an honor to get to be here and stand in this place and lead our time of study this morning. When Nate asked me to do this a few weeks ago, I said that I would, and you know the nerves began right then. But God has been gracious to give some thought to what we would talk about today. So I pray that this will be meaningful for you. I'm not a preacher, maybe a teacher, maybe a storyteller, and this is a good passage, I think, for some of that. But frankly, it's not just a story. So we want to look at this today and recognize there are some key points that God is giving us even today in the 21st century. Well, in China, in a man named, they call him Pastor Yun. His name is Lu Jinying. He's a pastor that wrote a book called The Heavenly Man. In this book, he describes the house church movement in the land of China. When Mao Zedong ran Chiang Kai-shek and the nationalists out and the communists took over, they systematically began to expel all Christian missionaries from the country. And as best as they could, they tried to destroy every Bible that they could find in the land. Pastor Yun and those like him suffered greatly at the hands of these oppressors. They were persecuted, they were tortured, many even murdered because of their faith in Jesus. But as time went on and Mao died and things began to change a little bit in the country, and I want to note that sadly things have reverted back to the way that mindset was then. Now we want to pray for them. But in that window, after things began to relax a little, church groups began to have opportunity to provide support to the church and the Christians in China. And so Bibles began to go back into the country, and the people were so excited because men and women, boys and girls now had the opportunity to once again read God's word in their heart language. And there was excitement in the church, and they were blessed as they worshiped together and as they shared the gospel and as lives were changed for the kingdom. Well, what happened next was, as time went on, some of these organizations began to include pamphlets and literature and information and tracts about their own particular beliefs, their own particular thoughts about how salvation ought to occur. And it began to infiltrate the church to the point that there became dissent within the church. The house church movement was without denominational walls. It was without the kinds of difficulties that can come sometimes from man's interpretation. But as that infiltration took place, people began to become dissentious toward one another. And as he describes it, the unity of the church was fractured. What was negatively impacted was their understanding, as we've sung already this morning, that salvation comes through grace alone, by faith alone, in Christ alone. And as things like baptism or communion, not necessarily in and of themselves bad, but as things such as that and other things began to rise to the level of importance in the minds of men, there was difficulty within the church. Well, today we're going to look at a passage where similar circumstances occurred, where salvation was becoming questioned, or basically the process towards salvation came in question because of the minds of men. We're going to look at chapter 15 of Acts. If you would stand, I'd like to read the first 20 verses of this chapter. Some men came down from Judea and were teaching the brothers, "Unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved." And after Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and debate with them, Paul and Barnabas and some of the others were appointed to go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and to the elders about this question. So being sent on their way by the church, they passed through both Phoenicia and Samaria, describing in detail the conversion of the Gentiles, and it brought great joy to all the brothers. When they came to Jerusalem, they were welcomed by the church and the apostles and the elders, and they declared all that God had done with them. But some believers who belonged to the party of the Pharisees, heard of them before, rose up and said, "It is necessary to circumcise them and to order them to keep the full law of Moses." The apostles and the elders were gathered together to consider this matter. After there had been much debate, Peter stood up and said to them, "Brothers, you know that in the early days God made a choice among you, by my mouth, and the Gentiles should hear the word of the gospel and believe. And God, who knows the heart, bore witness to them by giving them the Holy Spirit, just as he did to us. And he made no distinction between us and them, having cleansed their hearts by faith. Now, therefore, why are you putting God to the test by placing a yoke on the neck of the disciples that neither our fathers nor we have been able to bear? But we believe that we will be saved through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, just as they will." And all the assembly fell silent, and they listened to Barnabas and Paul as they related what signs and wonders God had done through them among the Gentiles. After they finished speaking, James replied, "Brothers, listen to me. Simeon has related how God first visited the Gentiles to take from them a people for his name. And with this, the words of the prophets agree, just as it is written, 'After this, I will return and I will rebuild the tent of David that has fallen. I will rebuild its ruins and I will restore it, that the remnant of mankind may seek the Lord, and all the Gentiles who are called by my name, says the Lord, who makes these things known of old.' Therefore, my judgment is that we should not trouble those of the Gentiles who turn to God, but should write to them to abstain from the things polluted by idols, and from sexual immorality, and from that that has been strangled, and from blood. From the ancient generations, Moses has had it in every city that those who proclaim him, for it's read every Sabbath in the synagogues." May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning, Lord, humbly bowing before you. Lord, I have no business being here aside from the fact that by your grace. And Lord, just to know that your word is pure and that it is instructive. And so may we, as we study this passage this morning, Lord, know that you and by your spirit would have for us as a church to understand, as individual believers to understand, and for those who need you, Lord, as our Savior, that they would understand. This is our prayer this morning in Christ's name. Amen. Please be seated. Well, the past few weeks, Nate's been, of course, preaching out of the book of Acts. Most recently, he was describing what we now call Paul's first missionary journey, and the joys and the challenges that they all faced as they were making their way around that part of the world. They're now back in Antioch, which is the church from whence they were first commissioned and left. They'd been to Cyprus, they'd been to Pamphylia, they'd been to Galatia. They'd seen God at work, they'd seen lives changed for the kingdom. And as they are giving a report in Antioch, the people are excited and joyous at what they're hearing. Well, then antagonists arrive, and they're there to try to quantify for those that are hearing the word what it takes to be saved. And they're going to declare that Gentiles must submit to the circumcision and to full obedience to the Mosaic law. By definition, they're saying you have to proselyte into Jewish faith in order to be saved. So grace alone is insufficient. Now, we've just sung a message about how grace is sufficient. And so it's a challenging question for the people to have to consider. One of the hardest ideas, I think, for humans, for us to accept, is the doctrine of salvation by grace. And Nate told us in the beginning, it's a gift of God that we cannot in any way, shape, form, or fashion earn or do anything to justify. It's a gift of his. And we struggle with that. We want to add something to it, right? A lot of them do. A lot of churches do. They add what? They add good works. They'll add baptism or infant baptism. They'll add certain rituals. They'll add even emotional, spiritual experiences as necessary to demonstrate one's salvation. All of these I would call a fatal misunderstanding of the gospel, or the doctrine, I'm sorry, of grace. I mean, there's one particular cult, I'll call it, that will tell you, yeah, you're saved by grace, but then they want to add on to it a little bit. In their scripture, it says we're saved by grace after all we can do. Think about that. That Christ's atonement just closes the gap, but we impact that gap. And that's not grace, right? Whether it's required church membership, whether it's required tithing as evidenced by you showing your annual income every year. I mean, there's ways for the grace plus to filter into their thinking. and it's wrong. It's a fatal misunderstanding. In the early church, it's the same. They're wanting to tie Judaism to salvation. Now think about these folks. These people, in the first Christians, came in Jerusalem after the day of Pentecost. Many of them were Jews, raised in the Jewish traditions. If you go back to chapter 6, verse 7, there's an interesting phrase there, a verse there that just, when I think about this, I wonder, you know, what is God telling us? The word of God continued to increase and the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem. And we can assume many of those were Jews, some Gentile converts, but many of the priests became obedient to the faith. Now that phrase is an interesting phrase to me. I think we can say that the priests probably got it. Some understood what it meant when the veil tore from the top on the day Christ was crucified. And when Christ was resurrected, they got it. They understood from the realm of their sacrificial practices over the years, and many came to faith. But I also wonder if maybe some of them, because that was their livelihood, held on to some of those Judaistic beliefs. Now, this is purely Daniel's personal opinion, okay? I don't know if they were somehow caught up in that conversation about keeping these things as a part of our salvation experience. As well as Gentiles who had been proselyted into the Jewish faith, they understood what that took as well. So there are many who are thinking these guys are right. Now, what's gone on is Paul and Barnabas, through God's Spirit, have presented the gospel to the Gentile world. The truth of the gospel has been given. We see in chapter 13, we saw in chapter 13, a Roman proconsul, Sergius Paulus, a Roman leader, came to faith. So, you know, there's evidence of God's reaching into the hearts of these, in those days, who were not Jews. And many others came to Christ along the way. So as these reports are being given back to the church in Antioch, they celebrated. It was a joyous word to them to hear how God had used Paul and Barnabas on their missionary trip. So this voice of dissension, and it has, let's remember, traveled some distance. I mean, it's not an easy trip from Judea or Jerusalem to Antioch. And so they had made some effort to go up there and to create this conversation. And they were demanding full adherence to the Mosaic law. I call it the doctrine of grace plus. Grace wasn't enough to them. It was grace plus. I want to say something here. If their voices were right, Paul and Barnabas were false prophets. If their voices were right, the solo fide, the justification by faith, is wrong, and Martin Luther's a liar. If their voices were right, then every Gentile believer since then up until now who's accepting Christ based upon grace alone, through faith alone, and Him alone, is not saved. Not long ago, we had a visitor here in church who, after the service, she was interacting with Pastor Nate. She asked him a question. She said, "Do you observe the holy days?" And so he asked her, he said, "Do you mean, do we follow the Jewish calendar and honor those holidays and feasts as they are defined in that?" "No." And she said, "Then why do you only believe half the Bible?" And she then caught one of our church members in the parking lot and proceeded to try to convince her that she was not saved and she would not go to heaven because of her ignorance about being a Christian. She's trapped in this idea of grace plus. Well, apparently Paul and Barnabas stood up. It says that they stood up with some vigor to oppose this word that was coming from these men of Judea. And so the church had to send these guys, or chose to send these guys and others, to Jerusalem. Go to Jerusalem, meet with the church leaders, and let's reconcile this issue. Let's find an answer to what's the right thing here, because they were struggling with what they were hearing. And the Jerusalem church welcomed them. They celebrated their arrival. The church, the leaders, were glad to see them. They were excited to hear the reports, as they too were hearing from Paul and Barnabas. And then the voice of dissension emerges again, this time more clearly defined. These converts who were Pharisees. And they're making the same claims as what those in Antioch had said. You cannot be saved unless you are fully following the Mosaic law. So the church leaders said, all right, let's consider this. They took it under consideration. Now, this isn't the first time that this issue was presented to the Jerusalem leaders. Previously, and we see it in chapter 10, you remember the story, Nate preached on this a few weeks ago. Paul, in a vision, sleeping in a vision, saw a sheet come down from heaven. And a lot of the food, the animals, the things on the sheet were forbidden to eat. And God told him nothing is forbidden. He was faithful as God directed him to go meet a man named Cornelius and his family. Peter did so, and he went and witnessed to this man and their family, and God saved them. And so Peter is reporting this back to the leaders in Jerusalem, and we can see this in chapter 10, and then we'll look in chapter 11 as he reports this. I'll read the first four verses, and then we'll look at the last, or a couple of 17 and 18. So the apostles and the brothers who were throughout Judea heard that the Gentiles also had received the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcision party, criticized him, saying, "You went to uncircumcised men and you ate with them." Peter began and explained to them in order. "I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision, something like a great sheet descending." He goes on and he tells them the account, gives testimony of this account of what happened and how God saved this man and his family. And so then in verses 17 and 18, Peter says, "If then God gave the same gift to them as he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could stand in God's way?" When they heard these things, they fell silent, and they glorified God, saying, "Then to the Gentiles also God has granted repentance that leads to life." See, they've already had this conversation, and they came to the conclusion that these Gentiles can be saved without those stipulations. But they're not yet there. So we see now in chapter 15, once again, this issue is before the church leaders, and Peter stands up to speak. Now again, he gives testimony, reiterates what happened with Cornelius and his family, and how it was clear to him that God makes no distinction between believers, whether it's based on the fact that they are previously Jews or previously pagan. Previous beliefs don't enter into the equation. It's by grace and grace alone. And then he goes on and he asks them a question, okay? Kind of confronting them with that rhetorical question that they know the answer to, but they don't want to speak it. Verses 10 and 11, we see what he says. He says, "Therefore, why are you putting God to the test by placing a yoke on the neck of the disciples that neither our fathers nor we have been able to bear? But we believe that we will be saved through the grace of the Lord Jesus, just as they will." Why are you asking them to do something you can't do? It's a pretty important question. After which they grew silent. I think that's a great verse. They're silent. You can imagine this gathering where they're talking and they're going back and forth and wanting their voices to be heard. And Peter poses this question and they grew silent. So then Paul and Barnabas again share their experiences of when they traveled around that part of Asia. And they don't talk about the doctrine they preached, or they don't talk about the theology they shared. They talk about the experiences of witnessing what God was doing in people's lives and how those lives are being changed. The evidence that God was at work among the Gentiles. So after Peter, the beloved apostle, has spoken, James stands up. James, the half-brother of Jesus, the leader of the church in Jerusalem, and the leader of this council, understood that this was a challenging issue before the Jews, not the Gentiles. I mean, the Gentiles were being called upon to do something by this group that was wrong, and they were going to address it. He recognizes that the Jews are the one that are having to wrestle with it the most. So he says, "Simeon," now when he uses the name Simeon, it's like he's wanting to heighten their attention. He doesn't call him Simon, doesn't call him Peter. He calls him by his Hebraic name, Simeon. I shared earlier, it's kind of like if I want to make a point, maybe Nate preached on something a couple weeks ago and I want to remind us of it and I want to make a point of it, I'm going to say, now, Dr. McLaughlin said, let's understand something here, folks, he says. And he declares that the Gentile believers are saved without having to become Jewish proselytes. Look at verse 19. My judgment is that we should not trouble those of the Gentiles who turn to God. Saying Gentile believers are truly members of God's people. And then he used an Old Testament reference to help. He begins with Abraham. Look in verse 14. He says, Simeon has related how God first visited the Gentiles to take from them a people for his name. He's talking about Abraham. Every good Israelite will track his existence back to being a child of Abraham. Right? Anybody ever sing a song, Father Abraham had many sons? They don't go back to Terah or Terah, who was his father. They go back to him. He was not an Israelite when God called him. Now, the people of Israel did descend through him as God promised. But he's just saying to the folks, look, our heritage is actually a Gentile heritage. If you really want to get down and admit it, that's who we are. I mean, what justified Abraham? They want to be justified based on their descendants, if that's a word, of Abraham. Abraham was justified because of his faith, not because of anything that he did to earn it. So it's an important connection James makes. And then he goes on in this passage in Amos. Really, let's look at the passage over in the book of Amos. Amos, a prophet, a farmer from Tekoa, a small village in the south. God said, go to the northern kingdom and tell those people I'm going to judge them harshly. And Amos was faithful and he did so. It's recorded in this passage. He says, in that day I will raise up the booth of David that has fallen and repair its breaches and raise up its ruins and rebuild it as in the days of old, that they may possess the remnant of Edom. And all the nations who are called by my name, declares the Lord, who does this. Notice what he says there. He says all the nations. James, in his recording of it, he says all the Gentiles. That's synonymous. When it says all the nations in the Old Testament, it's describing other than Israel. And anyone outside Israel, we know, would be called a Gentile. James says all the Gentiles. And who did it? God does it. They bear my name. Anyone who bears God's name is in God's family. Amen? They bear his name because he did this. And so he's making the point, grace alone, faith alone, and through Christ alone is exactly how it works, not because of anything else that we do. That's the message that James wants to deliver. Now, the way he chooses to do this, he goes on and he says, well, we're going to write a letter. We're going to send a letter to these churches, and we're going to give them a report. Now, when you have a council, you have a gathering, at the end of it, there's usually a report, right? I mean, the Southern Baptists just met in Anaheim. So we know that from that, there will be documents that will be released that will say the decisions that have been made. There have been councils throughout history, the Nicene Council. There have been times when Christians have come together and said, you know, we've got some issues here. We need to work these out. We need to reconcile these. And throughout history, we can see evidence of how God has blessed those gatherings, just like here. And so James is saying, we've got a decision here. We need to communicate this decision. And the amazing thing about this is that through this communication, through these conversations, through the decisions that are being made, the Spirit of God had Luke record them in the book of Acts. It's Scripture. And Scripture is inerrant. And we can now look at Scripture and know how these kinds of issues need to be addressed without great debate, frankly, although it can happen. We'll talk about that in just a second. He says in this letter, he writes a letter. Notice in the letter, when he's talking about the contents of this letter, he doesn't say anything about circumcision. He tells them, let's look at verses 28 through 31. For it has seemed good. It has seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to lay on you no greater burden than these requirements, that you abstain from what has been sacrificed to idols and from blood and from what has been strangled and from sexual immorality. If you keep yourself from these, you will do well. Farewell. So when they were sent off, they went down to Antioch, and having gathered the congregation together, they delivered the letter. And when they had read it, they rejoiced because of its encouragement. So they put in this letter. He said, what is the words? He said, you, here are these requirements. Now, he's not tying these requirements to salvation. He's not saying, here's the path to salvation. He's not. Well, what is he saying? Well, let's just note that there's two. There's two that deal with idolatry, and there's two that deal with fellowship. When he tells them not to engage in eating foods that have been sacrificed or to engage in idolatrous behavior and to avoid sexual immorality, both of these, when you think about them in that world, now these people, they're Gentile. He's telling them not to eat these things. He's telling them not to do these things. Well, when he's telling them not to do these things, they are culturally acceptable. Engaging in these rituals around idolatry are culturally acceptable. So even acts of sexual immorality were culturally acceptable. And what James is saying to them, he's saying those are not in line with the church, with being a follower of Jesus Christ. First commandment says, one God only, speaks against idolatry, make no graven images of me. And so the eating of meat, if that meat was sacrificed to an idol, well, if it was at a feast associated with the idol, of course, don't go there. He's telling them, that's not, I'm going to tell you, it's a requirement. Don't do that. Even if you eat meat that's been offered to an idol, you got to be careful. And Paul deals with this in Romans. He says it's not necessary that you don't eat that meat. Just understand that as you do, don't pay homage to the idol or idols to which it was originally offered. Don't sit there and hope if it was offered to a fertility god that maybe you get a little benefit from it. That's compromising our faith in Christ and our trust in Christ. And so James is trying to make a very clear message here to them that these behaviors are against what faith in God means. Cultural issues. It kind of resonates today, does it not? I mean, we heard earlier, we don't want the world infiltrating our beliefs. In the world, and these two issues can still come into play at some level, in the world today. It's sad to me that two historically strong evangelical Protestant denominations are being blown up over cultural issues, over an acceptance of things that this specifically speaks to, over tolerance to issues that this specifically speaks to, especially in the realm of sexual immorality. I mean, the Presbyterians and Methodists, it's sad to think about those two denominations and what they've gone through. And we have to recognize to some extent it's going on with our convention as well, where there's a push to be tolerant for. And James is telling them it's essential, which means don't be tolerant. It's an important message for the church. Well, the other two, eating blood and the meat from strangled animals, this was abhorrent to Jews. A friend shared with me this morning that if you go back to the covenant God made with Noah, he told them, don't do these two things in that covenant. So for the history, long history of the people of Israel, they had considered those abhorrent. Now, God told Peter, these things, they're not forbidden. So that's an interesting dynamic for them to work through, but it was still abhorrent. And I'll say this, we love going to Asia. Many of you in the room, I see you, you've been there with us, even Peru. Sometimes they eat stuff, I'm thinking, I mean, if they call it stinky, I'm not eating it. I'm just saying. What he's saying to the Gentiles, now remember, these are cities that are apart from Palestine, and the people there are Gentile people. and they're coming to faith. When Paul wrote the letter to the Romans, he was talking to the house churches in Romans. Remember, churches then, they didn't look like this. They were house churches. They were small groups of people who came together, and they were coming from where? They were coming from paganism. They were coming from Judaism. They were slaves. They were masters. It was quite diverse within the body of those believers. And James is encouraging them to be mindful of everyone within your body. Paul talks about it when he says, don't be a stumbling block. When he talks about the heart of the mature versus the weak, or the strong versus the weak Christian, and he challenges both of them, really, to understand within the framework of those relationships and be respectful toward things. I tried to come up with a good analogy. The only one I came up with is not a good one, but, you know, if you're having a new family in church and you invite them over for lunch and you happen to know that they're vegetarians, don't offer them fried chicken. That may oversimplify it, but that's kind of what James is saying. He's saying, understand each other. And for the Gentiles, it'll be real important you understand that regardless, these things, they're not ever going to work. And for some of us, it may be that we think we've got liberty because we are in Christ, and by his word we do. But there may be things that we have brothers and sisters, and we know that it's an issue for them. And we have to be respectful of that. Why? For the fellowship and the unity of the church. So James was trying to outline, I think, or James was outlining, maybe he didn't realize it, but he was outlining for the 21st century church ways for us to be mindful of each other and understand that the fellowship within the church is important. It's about spiritual health and church unity. So the result, when it returned to Antioch, was excitement and joy. And it should be for us too. A word of excitement and joy. Because grace and grace alone is the pathway to salvation, right? There's nothing we can do to earn it. Nothing. James Montgomery Boyce, great 20th century pastor and theologian, he quoted another theologian, Everett Harrison, saying the Jerusalem Council accomplished several important things. The gospel of divine grace was reaffirmed. The unity of the church was safeguarded, as he described the behaviors for them to engage in that would protect the unity of the church. Evangelism of the Gentiles could proceed without hindrance. Remember, most of the churches that were formed in that time frame came after this council when Paul and Barnabas and others went back to the then known world. And then Gentile churches that had already been established were encouraged by this word. And the fact that it's in Scripture gives us guidance that we don't have to argue about anymore. We don't have to wonder what else do we need to do in order to be saved. What was being missed by those who were trying to hold on to Judaism? What was missed is what Christ has done for us. He told them when he was on earth, I didn't come to abolish the law, I came to fulfill it. The law in and of itself is good. In Matthew 11, 28 through 30, Jesus says, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. See, Jesus took the burden of works-based righteousness. If you think of the law as a pathway toward works-based righteousness, Jesus took care of that for us. When he said, I fulfill the law, that's what he's saying. I fulfilled that. He took the burden of that from us by his perfect life, where he fulfilled it, by his sacrificial death on the cross, which he died for our sins there, not his. He gloriously was raised on the third day and subsequently ascended into heaven where he is today. He took care of it. And we have the joy of knowing that, hearing that, and being able to embrace that. As you're here this morning, if you need Jesus, if you need to put your trust in him for the first time, this grace that's being described here was discussed and reconciled in the minds of the people then, is now, it's here for us today. Scripture says, for all who confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For all that call on the name of Christ will be saved. That's available today for those who still need him. For us who have him, who've made that recognition and called upon him for our salvation, We need to assess our commitment to be the Pauls and Barnabases of this day and be faithful in our proclamation of who Jesus is to a lost world. And we need to pray for the unity within the church, that our church will adhere faithfully to God's word. We're beginning our 29th year at Trinity Baptist Church this next month, and we love this church. And we don't always agree on everything, but we need to be of one heart and one mind when it comes to salvation by grace through faith in Christ alone. And we need to be faithful in delivering that to those we know and even those we don't. So in a moment, we're going to have an invitation. If you need to make that step toward a relationship with Jesus and put your faith and hope in him, Pastor Nate's going to be here at the front. He'd be glad to visit with you. Any of us after, we'd be glad to visit with you if you want to talk to us after church. If you've made that profession and you've not yet been baptized, not because it's essential to salvation, but because it's important to making a statement about what Christ has done in your life, we'd love to talk to you about baptism, how that can happen within our church. If you're looking for a church home and like to know more about church membership, of course, we'll be glad to talk with you about that too. And finally, we can all pray. Pray for the unity of our church. Pray for the unity of our convention. Pray that the convictions that are in line with God's word will remain firm. Let's stand and let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning. We thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you, Lord, for the instruction you give us in your word, for the assurance you give us in your word, for the encouragement that we get through seeing you at work long ago and knowing that those things that were talked about then are real today, and we have guidance from you. So by your Spirit, Lord, may we be faithful to adhere to that. Lord, we pray your Spirit will move in hearts and minds of everyone here this morning. For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon
dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
Pray with me. Father, today we declare that this church, we believe the true, authentic gospel, the gospel of grace and grace alone, no law, God, just grace. And we believe that Jesus Christ fulfilled the law perfectly, and that despising the shame, he went to the cross on our behalf for the joy that was set before him. And Father, I pray that we would not conform to the world, but that we would conform to the word of God, and that we would conform to Christ. And I pray that we would love our brothers and sisters, and that we would be willing to give up things that might be a stumbling block to the unity of the church. God, we need your help, and we ask you for your help. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Please be seated for just a few minutes. Now, you might be wondering why I'm still up here, even though Hunter and Heather have already come. Well, it's because I've moved into a college ministry role, and I like to think that when Pastor Nate thought about coming up to the office and not being able to see me, he just couldn't bear the thought. And so he offered this job to me so I can stay on staff through the summer. And so for that reason, you're still going to get to hear me say that here at Trinity Baptist Church, we exist to proclaim Christ, to make disciples of those who claim Christ, all for the glory of Christ. And one of the ways we do this is through supporting local and international missions and ministries, and that's through your generous giving. So we're thankful for your giving. And as a reminder, you can drop your gifts in the giving boxes in the back of the room. You can give on the church website, or you can bring your gift by the church office throughout the week. I have a few announcements to bring to your attention. The first one is that we have a church-wide picnic at Austin Park tonight at 6 p.m. Bring $1, and that'll cover hot dogs and hamburgers for you. And then we're asking people to bring sides and desserts to share. And this is also serving as a welcome event for Hunter and Heather Wilkerson, so you'll want to be sure that you come and say hi to them. And as a reminder, we're collecting gifts and cards for them at the Welcome Center and the office today and next week. Two more announcements. First, the Hope Choice baby bottle campaign is coming to an end today. If you forgot to bring your baby bottle, please still bring the bottle to the church office sometime this week. And then last announcement, Buckner Family Pathways is having a Bible study over the next 6 weeks, and mothers that are participating in that Bible study need help with childcare. They meet on Thursdays from 6 to 8 p.m., and they're in need of 2 childcare volunteers each week. And if you can help meet this need, please get with Deborah Miller, and they need the volunteers ASAP because the Bible study has already started. So once again, 6 to 8 p.m. on Thursday nights, 2 volunteers every week to help with childcare. You can get with Deborah Miller if you're able to meet that need. Our benediction today, I'm going to read from Romans 15:13. It says, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope." Church, you're dismissed. Have a great Sunday.